Hello everyone, this is Bob and Threadbare, and welcome back to Sleeping Dogs. Now, the plot has been kind of speeding up as we get towards the end because the game had kind of this hurried development cycle near the ending. But now we're about to hit overdrive. Well, all right then. Guess we're going to go meet Jackie again for the election. I should get dressed properly for this. These drunken master rags just won't do. Let's see, what will? Ah, yes. Sun Wukong. He's respected. And he's got this awesome moveset, too. See, if you use heavy attacks, he summons that famous staff. And you even get a 3-heavy combo. That doesn't exist without this outfit. This outfit is awesome. I'm going to be totally ready for the end game. Speaking of which, I should get an appropriate car while I'm at it. Ah yes, of course. Yeah, cry some more. Yep, that's right. It's time for me to get out my own land yacht.
Jackie? The fuck? Oh, fuck.
That
Jackie
is a messed up guts Jackie texture.
Motherfucker!
Man, you don't cold cock the Monkey King.
Hello, Mr. Shen. Or should I say, Officer Shen. My name is Mr. Tom. Perhaps you heard of me?
Fuck you! I'm no cop!
Your friend Jackie didn't think so. He was most loyal. But then, I expect you wouldn't have told him anything.
You must be a very dangerous man, Wei Shen.
Son of a bitch, I'll kill you!
Oh, save your energy, Mr. Shen. You'll need it. The last cop I had in this chair lasted almost 48 hours. Would you like to try for a new record?
I understand your personal reasons for doing this, your history with the Sun On Yi. You do what must be done.
There were rumors. Before I'm done with you, you will confirm them. And then you will die.
That's what worries me, Wei. You're one of them.
That's the attitude that makes us strong. Loyalty, discretion.
Zhang will be disgraced, and Big Smile Li will be elected head of the Sun On Yi. Call me when he comes around. There's no rush.
Why didn't they put the chair on the tarp? Also, was that his life flashing before his eyes? Is that what that was supposed to be? Said call him when he came around. Don't punch him out again. Come on, man. The guy's a professional torturer. He can do that way better than you can.
Fuck.
I gotta take a piece. I'm gonna check on our boy.
Ah, Great. Oh, damn. Man, Wei Shen is doing pretty well for a guy who was fell unconscious from shock due to several open wounds caused by scalpels, drill, hammer blows to the feet. Also, you may notice, but yeah, costume's gone. We're in serious mode now. Can't do any costumes from here on until the game ends. Disappointing. Not really unexpected, but disappointing. Also, this is where they had the staggering in the original game that they used for the tournament DLC. Also, you know that's not hooked up to any plumbing, right? The stick is just gonna stay there. Here, let me give you a demonstration! Apparently! Oh, Jesus. Yeah, there was no water in there. He drowned in his own piss. Hey, look at that. That's an interesting effect. The bloody footprints. You can see the bunch there where I was trying to figure out where to stand to get the button command. He is a red pole, so they would need a good excuse. But yep, looks like it's,
Guys, he got out! Got the cops on!
Oh man, lightning reflexes there, guy.
He's killing everybody!
Yep, still using Dim Mach. Which, someone has kindly confirmed to me that that is, Chinese. Yeah, this place is full of environmentals. Let's use them all. As I was trying to say before I interrupted myself, the time when Wei Shen is inconvenienced by torture is now officially over. You can see just right down there with the health. There's no mechanical downside to being tortured either. Uh-oh. God. That's gotta suck too. I can't imagine being impaled on something blunt like that pipe would be any better than being impaled on something sharp. But yeah, we got a pretty nice hand-to-hand section here right at the very end. Uh-oh. I think they may have found me. Yeah, unique environment up here, too. You just look at that background. Oh, shit. Yeah, man, look at him parkouring, doing a pull-up like a champ there. I wonder if I just did his wife a favor or not.
Shit! He got out!
And hey, yeah. What do you know? It's not just the one combat section here. Hand-to-hand combat section, I should say. I think I was pressing the wrong button just now. So yeah, that's the right one. There we go. Alright, now one of you is going over this railing. I don't care. I don't know which one of you is going to go over the railing, but it's definitely going to be one of you. Maybe the big guy. No. Oh, I guess not that guy either. Oh, not him either. So I guess it's gonna have to be you. Yep, just face into the railing maybe once or twice more. Come on, come on. Oh yeah, here we go. Oh! And onto the railing too. Well, that wasn't the right way. Oh, man. I'm doing so terribly at this. Well, luckily he went down fast enough. Now it's time for mouse control. Yeah. Yeah, it's all under control. Uh-oh. Well, it looks like I'm stuck with the hammer for now. Why did I say hammer? Shotgun. It's like the firearms version of a hammer. Maybe. Oh man, he made it? God damn, look at that spread. Yeah, sure, a pistol's better. This is even better than a pistol. Or wait, no, is that the shotgun again? It is. Fine, I'll get close. Ah, finally, here we go. This is what I was looking for.
I knew you were there. It's all
time to use slow-mo some.
John, hold on!
that? You want to hide? Apparently you want to dance. Alright. Hey, what the hell? Oh, whatever. Ooh, two with one blow. Oh. Now let's me blow up that canister. So yeah, we aren't going to be finding the rifle anywhere in this room. That was just like to explain why we are switching from fighting with guns back to a fist fight. And I believe actually that both of these guys are a little tougher than normal. But you know, environmentals make that moot.
I suppose I should be impressed. You defeating my men like that.
Killing half of them.
I am not. Now. Where were we?
Damn, man. It's one hell of a machete you've got there.
But now amateur hour is over. Now you die.
Dude. Amateur hour
determination is impressive.
It's not what you call a man who killed 20 people.
You'll never win. Hear me? You'll never win, Wei.
But I will admit this about him. He was a legitimate boss fight. Ruin your knuckles like that, man. Faces are hard.
I'm sorry, Jackie. Fuck. Lee. Fuck the election. You did this, Lee. And I'm coming for you. Motherfucker.
Yep. Nothing left right now but revenge. Oh, come on, look at that. What the hell? But yeah, I did some experimentation here. Trying to see that if I could go anywhere except for the final mission location. And the answer to that is no. I can only go directly to the ending from here. And in fact, you cannot leave the car once you are in it. So here I am trying to find another car to take me to my nearest apartment. All right, yep. Here I am, picking out a route. What? How many people have seen that screen? I gotta tell ya, I'm showing you some unique stuff here. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, I think that did it. So let's get on with the end game since we have to. Have to do it in that mediocre suit. Nothing special.
I'm warning you here and now. Making anyone other than me the chairman will be disastrous for Sanonji.
You are an officer of the law, same as me.
Wait, if you have a problem with me, then let's sort it out ourselves, okay? We don't need to bring Han into this.
That's the attitude that makes us strong. Loyalty, discretion, used to be more common.
I'm here for Mr. Lee. I take it you've heard of Big Smile Lee.
That's what worries me, Wei. You're one of them.
But you cross Pedro, he's cut you off.
Anything happens to me, you look after our people, okay?
Where's Big Smile Lee, man? He's fucking grabbed me at the fucking funeral. Tossed me off the ATK, man.
You show your true colors tonight, brother.
Oh, God! I'm sorry, please! No, no, no!
We must stop this fight at once. We must be united against our true enemies.
No matter what happens, Jackie, I won't leave you behind.
Okay, so as soon as you get here, all the flashbacking stops. And oh man, that's a lot of flashbacking. Alright, so yeah, second attempt. Can I get to this apartment? The answer is yes, but I will not be able to change my outfit once I am there. And so I had to come back. Actually, I reset to a checkpoint so I wouldn't have to drive all the way back. Yeah, let's get some food in me. Oh. Being scared by the machete. Well, fair enough.
You got a sale.
Please come again.
Alright. Health regeneration and a machete. We're all set for the final part of the game's main story. And once again, we are starting with the melee section. It's only, yeah, they don't forget about it. Not completely. And this is more human trafficking, by the way. It's actually the same dialogue from an earlier section.
All right, who's first?
Damn, they got a lot of knives and cleavers here. I think that guy just did friendly fire. Uh-oh. Well, luckily this cleaver is just as good as you think it would be. One of those weapons that just does not break. Yeah, but unfortunately the melee section does end rather quickly for this final mission. But hey, at least I got an assault rifle. I mean, if I gotta be doing the running and gunning, then at least I'm doing it with a good weapon. Well, not quite yet. The game won't end until another 10 minutes or so.
Pick the wrong side, asshole.
That is becoming abundantly clear at this point. They want me to go through the window here. Well, maybe I will, but not until I clear the air down there beforehand. Yeah, I really don't think you're supposed to be taking the fight like this, like from up here. Because, you know, damn, I didn't expect that to happen. Yeah, normally you're not supposed to be this accurate because normally you're supposed to be using a controller. Plus, you know, eventually when you get rid of the guys in front, you got some very long-range enemies to deal with. So the game expects you to be moving forward as you're fighting. Which is why I am doing that right now. Hey, look at how well it's working. Damn, nothing to jump over this time. Oh! Whoops. That was an innocent.
I don't want to die. Take cover, everyone. Get down. Oh, no.
Yeah, that's a reasonable amount of panic.
Mommy, mommy, save me, mommy. $10,000 to whoever killed this.
Our father who art in heaven.
Only 10,000 in Hong Kong money?
Mr. Hong San, or don't be stupid!
Oh hey, it's that ponytail asshole.
I'm gonna kill you. Anyone who stands with Big Smiley.
I guess we do see him again. Just, you know, in a extremely reduced encounter. You can get several headshots off on this guy. Damn. Not go down. 190 from headshots on the one guy. Yeah, sure, let's take his golden pistol.
Surprise!
Shit.
Time to die, Lee.
Fuck you!
What, seriously? Buckshot to the shoulder area? That's not gonna slow him down? Oh. Apparently it does slow him down. Until now. Now he's going at full tilt. Rolls and everything. Hey, that whooshing sound is for way only. Don't use it. His suit is nice and clean and free of his own blood now, too. Of course.
You pussy!
You're done!
Piece of fucking shit. Fuck! How does it feel, Pig? To know that your boss sold you out? And you fucked your way almost as bad as you fucked Jackie. You were supposed to die with Winston. Dog Eyes blew that. And that poke guy Tong, fucking worthless Lanyang. But that's okay. Because I am gonna enjoy killing you myself.
Fuck you.
So this is an interesting final boss fight. You can counter just fine, but if you try it and punch, he does this sort of limp, weak whiff through the air like that.
Is that all you got?
But somehow his counters are all just completely on point, even so. Also, you can't grab him. I just tried and you saw what happened. But hey, you can, even with as wimpy as the punches are, you can still connect with them. Which is pretty funny when it finishes the fight. Well, not quite finishes. I mean, we do have this one environmental left to go. Jesus Christ, Wei. But his suit is okay.
Raymond.
Hey, easy there, Wei. This man is in my custody.
Yes, sir.
You okay?
Yeah. Where's Pendrew?
He's up for promotion. Interpol. He's done with us.
He's dirty, Raymond. He outed me to Big Smile Lee.
Take it from me, Wei. Whatever you heard, it won't matter. The only voice they hear is Pendrew's. You did what you came here to do. All right? Let's get you cleaned up.
Jang? The fuck?
Aunt Jang, now. I guess she must have fully replaced Uncle Po.
Uncle Po? Pendrew? What the hell?
Superintendent Pendrew, I'm surprised to see you. You're the one who chased my boys away?
Poe, you know why I'm here.
I can imagine all sorts of reasons. I'm sure you will tell me.
I'm moving on to greener pastures, but not without taking care of some unfinished business with you and Sonny first.
We had a deal, did we not, Pendrew? I gave you the three tigers. It made your career.
And I let you and Sonny continue operating.
A sacrifice you were willing to make.
At the time. I'm putting Sonny away, and with you gone, I'll finish this once and for all.
The only difference between you and me is... I know what I am.
Jesus Christ. Pendrew, I've got you, you son of a bitch.
Great, so does that mean that there's another Nope. We just arrested Pendrew. I mean, it makes sense. He's no fighter. Doesn't really have a giant gang at his beck and call, but still, it's kind of underwhelming.
What would you like me to say? Whatever I did, I made Hong Kong a better place. I served the greater good. But you let them get to you. You abandoned your duty, officer, and became one of them. You deserve to be handed over to Big Smile Lee.
Did I? Well, Pendrew, I guess everyone gets what he deserves. Including you. You ready for life in prison?
What?
Because all your old buddies are gonna be waiting for you. I made sure they found out what you did to Uncle Poe.
That's a fucking death sentence!
I know.
Way you can't! I won't last a day in there!
That's the plan.
Damn, Way.
Inspector.
Officer?
I just wanted to say thanks.
For what? It's me who should
be... For helping me close cases. Do something I could feel good about. Hell, for helping me stay sane.
My pleasure. So, what are you gonna do now?
I don't know. Job's over, but I don't really have anywhere else to go. Strange to say it after all that's happened, but Hong Kong kind of feels like home.
Well, it kind of was when you were growing up.
Yeah. But which Hong Kong, officer?
And what about Wei Shen?
He proved himself to be loyal to me, one way or the other. And isn't that what really matters? Leave him be.
Yes, Aunt Jane. Drive.
When did they record footage of that? He's outed as a cop now. They know that. Oh well. So, Sleeping Dogs Definitive Edition. I have to admit, I had a lot of fun playing this game. A lot more than I have for some of the previous games I've LP'd, honestly. I mean, just putting in some of that chaos, some of that randomness that infected the cutscenes at times. That was fun. Even the bugs where you just suddenly pop up like you're flying like Superman. That's great entertainment, even if it wasn't intended on the part of the developers. But yeah, the ending is definitely unfortunate. I mean, not only did the melee, the hand-to-hand combat sections sort of drop off. Like, they didn't disappear completely, but they did drop off towards the end. But also the ending itself is rather abrupt. I mean, you can tell that they, you know, went to a different developer and had to finish everything in 6 months. But you know, if I had to choose between that and not getting Sleeping Dogs at all, I would definitely say I prefer this. I prefer getting the game with a rushed ending as opposed to not getting a game at all, which was my only other reasonable alternative. I can only imagine what the movie is going to be like if that actually gets out of production. Bloody as hell, that's for sure. Also, I've done something unusual this time because the credits are just so long, and I wanted this to be in one video and not two, of which one would be half the credits. So I have cut the credits short. I have skipped a whole bunch of them in the middle here. We'll come up to it before too long, you'll notice, because the music will skip. But the point is that there is a little bit of after-credits stuff. Bookkeeping, I guess. So I'll see you when we get to that part, which won't take very long at all. Yeah, most of it was just music credits for some reason. Don't know why they had to take so long just to show all of that. Yeah, plainclothes cop outfit. Final point of triad experience. Let's do it. And we got that last little report. Let's have a look at that. It's about Pendrew. Where was it? Ah, here we go. Internal Affairs Report, Thomas Pendrew. Yeah, it confirms that he made his career by putting away three major triad bosses, which incidentally also helped Uncle Poe reach the heights that he eventually got. And yeah, he's been sort of helping the Sonon Yi on the sly this entire time. And hey, look it over here. That golden pistol is just sort of sitting there on the floor. Nice. But unneeded at the moment. Because I have done everything. I mean, there's a couple random street events. But the main game is over. Well, since that was the last main video, once again, it's my turn to pick a movie. It's a real doozy of a film, too. 2005's The Protector, also known in its original Thai as Tom Yong Goong. The story about the story. So, between Ong Bak and Chocolate, I've pretty much said all I need to say when it comes to The Protector's backstory. Thailand had a growing film industry, Tony Jaa is a major star thanks to Ong Bak, and his follow-up film, Tom Yong Goong, had an even bigger budget and became an even bigger hit. Ong Bak made $20 million off a $1 million budget, and The Protector spent $5 million to get a $27 million return. However, when The Protector came to America, it got pretty thoroughly mangled. It wasn't distributed by Miramax, but let me tell you guys a quick story here. Miramax was founded in 1993 by the Weinstein brothers, which, yes, includes Harvey Weinstein, but the sexual abuse stuff is beside the point in this case. Harvey Weinstein was the one who brought over foreign films and then butchered them for American audiences. In 2005, he and his brother left Miramax to form a new company, the Weinstein Company. They did this just in time for the new company to acquire the rights to Tom Yong Goong. And while the film's international release is slightly shorter than the original 108 minutes, the Weinsteins cut it down to 84 minutes. They cut so much from the film that they had to shorten the fight scenes. The fight scenes! Oh yeah, and they also slapped Quentin Tarantino Presents on the front of the film, even though he had nothing to do with this movie. Apparently the Weinsteins thought that his name was part of the reason Hero did so well, when Miramax released it the year before. Now, you can get the uncut Thai version in America in a two-disc DVD set, but sadly, I got my copy from a Hollywood video that was going out of business, so I only have the disc with the short version. So, I guess we should just move on to the story. The movie begins with a brief bit of exposition. The protagonist, Cam, was born into an order of Muay Thai warriors tasked with protecting the Thai king's elephants. The boy bonds with two elephants in particular, Por Yai and his young son, Korn. Cam and Korn grow up together in some frankly melodramatic shots, and the melodrama only increases when a bunch of ethnically Chinese poachers show up and accidentally kill Korn's mother. And for some reason, their lines are dubbed into English, even though the Thai is subtitled. Sometime later, Cam and his father Khoi bring Por Yai and Korn into town, so the king's examiner can have a look at them. but Korn wanders off, and it turns out that the examination is a ruse to steal poor guy, because the Chinese guys show back up to take it away. When Koi protests, they shoot him, and some other guys grab Korn while Cam is running around in a panic. Oh, and apparently Cam and his father are the only two people who speak Thai in the movie, because some of the other Thai guys have been dubbed, or something. It's weird, but I'll stop pointing it out for now. Anyway, poor Yai chases after Korn and destroys half the festival in the process, but in the end, they both get captured before Cam can stop them. Cam is upset, and so when he tracks down the man who took his elephants and killed his father, he starts smashing them through doors and kicking them into walls. Fun fact, by the way, throughout this entire movie, Tony Jaa never opens a door except with someone else's face. In the end, he reaches the man in charge and hears from him that the elephants were shipped to a man named Johnny in Sydney, Australia. We then get an extended speedboat chase as Jaa tries to get away, and we get some pretty crazy stunts as the boats run into everything along the bank. Hell, a helicopter shows up eventually and gets hit by a ramping boat. 2 weeks later, Cam lands in Australia, and we get a brief cameo by a man who is not, but looks very similar to, Jackie Chan. And now that we're in an English-speaking country, we start meeting characters who speak English without needing to get dubbed in later. Although very often, they are anyway. Cam gets into a taxi and gives the driver a picture of Johnny, since it has the name of a business behind him, Tom Young Goom. Unfortunately, things go from zero to crazy in a second, because it turns out the driver stole the taxi. Oh, and Tony Jaa's buddy from Ong Bak is now an Australian cop, which I have to say is rather disconcerting. The car chase ends with a standoff, but the driver tries to take Cam hostage, and that ends about as well as you'd expect. But then, some shady-looking police lieutenant shoots at Cam, and when Cam runs, he tells the uniformed officers to go arrest him. A brief foot chase ensues, but this time the police catch up to Cam, and the Thai officer takes him into custody. In the police car, Cam explains to the Thai officer, Sergeant Mark, that he's looking for elephants. They then stop near Tom Yung Goom, which it turns out is a Thai restaurant frequented by Johnny. I was wondering why Google Translate said the name meant boiled shrimp, and I guess that's my answer. Anyway, Cam spots Johnny drive away, and when the police car goes in a different direction, Cam gets desperate and escapes. We cut to a boardroom meeting with a bunch of wealthy Chinese guys and Madame Rose, a transgender Chinese woman, played by a transgender Chinese woman, whose gender identity does not get brought up once, at least not in the American cut. She feeds her Uncle Sam a bowl of turtle soup, but he is not impressed by her or her soup. I should also add that this time the Chinese characters are speaking Cantonese. Oh, and we find out that Rose is the one who stole the elephants so that she could use them as a good luck charm. Back with Cam, he has once again managed to track down gangsters in cars, while on foot, and he confronts Johnny on a bridge. Johnny kicks Cam twice and lays him out, but that's only because he caught Cam off guard. Johnny walks away, but Cam beats up his two buddies and gets one of them to take him to Johnny by kicking the lamp from a lamppost. Cam interrupts Johnny's drug deal, and this upsets Johnny enough for him to summon a roaming band of gangster rollerbladers, BMXers, and dirt bikers, wielding fluorescent bulbs. Yeah, you fucking heard me. And as you might have guessed, this movie is more concerned about having awesome fight scenes than about explaining them. And oh hey, look, the ATV gangster got here late and god damn, that shot with the window. Following the fight, the Thai woman who was with Johnny finds Cam passed out in an alley. And over in the police precinct, Mark and his partner are taken off the Cam case and told to help Inspector Vincent, the shady detective from earlier, with security for Mr. Sim's meeting with the police commissioner. Cam wakes up in the Thai woman's apartment, and I should probably mention that her name is Pia. While she's out, Pia sees a news report on Cam that ties him to the drug deal, but she doesn't get back before the police find her place. Fortunately, Cam just escapes out the window. The commissioner and Mr. Sim meet in a spa. It turns out Pia's day job is working as a call girl for Mr. Sim. But the commissioner has a heart attack from overstimulation, and Pia runs into the closet for his pills, which is good timing on her part, since a time man shows up and shoots both Sim and the commissioner. Then Inspector Vincent shows up to kill the time man and Mark's partner, only sparing Mark, so that he can frame him for all of the murders. But Mark escapes. When Vincent's men run after him, Pia grabs a camera that saw the whole thing and runs off. Sadly, it's not long before Johnny captures Mark by kidnapping his girlfriend, and Pia gets taken in by the police. But there is one man out there who hasn't been caught yet. Cam. Cam rescues Pia from the police, and so she tells him everything she knows. Johnny is Madame Rose's minion, and Tom Yong-gung is a front. Obviously, Vincent is also on Rose's payroll, and she killed Mr. Sim to take over the organization. Cam heads straight to the restaurant and immediately starts beating up the guards, and... oh boy, here we go. Allow me to explain. You know how that one long, single-cut fight scene in Old Boy was just a big joke on the audience? Well, what we've got here is the real deal. For 5 uninterrupted minutes, a single Steadicam follows Tony Jaa as he fights his way up a long, spiraling ramp. No tricks, no composites, and the only CG to speak of is some broken glass coming off one of the doors. It is absolutely amazing. And it's one of the main reasons I chose this movie instead of Ong Bak as one of my landmark films. At the top of the ramp, Johnny shows up and tosses Korn's bell to Cam. This upsets Cam, especially when he notices that the patrons at the back of the restaurant are eating endangered animals. And this distraction allows Johnny to kick him a bunch using Taekwondo. But of course, this has only made Cam angry. In the following fight, Johnny gets some decent hits in, but ultimately, Cam kicks his ass. He then fights his way through a pantry full of endangered animals and finds a back room where Mark is tied up, and a bunch of strung-out women are practically piled up in the back. After Cam frees Mark, he finds Korn, but poor Yai is still missing, and Johnny still has Mark's girlfriend. As the police arrive at the restaurant to shut it down, Cam, Mark, and Korn take shelter at a Buddhist temple. But Madame Rose isn't about to take this disgrace lying down, especially when her position in the triad is still tenuous thanks to rampant misogyny. Eventually, someone spots Mark at the temple, so later that night, Rose's forces have set fire to the shrine and shot the monk. Of course, this was mostly to give us an interesting stage for the next set of fights. Challenger 1 is a capoeirista with the word prey carved into his chest. He seems to be having a lot of fun fighting Cam, and Cam only manages to beat him when he starts using some very non-Muay Thai breakdancing moves. Then Challenger 2 shows up, a kung fu fighter with a Chinese broadsword. They cut down a gong in the fight, so Cam grabs a couple of gong mallets to use against him. But then the third challenger bursts in through the door, and it's a fucking American wrestler. And he actually was, too. Nathan Jones had a very brief career in the WWE before retiring to Australia. Jones was also in Mad Max Fury Road as Rictus Erectus, Immortan Joe's hulking son. Anyway, in this movie, Jones is so big and tough that none of Cam's moves even faze him. He throws Cam around like he was made of straw, and in the end, Cam only gets away because the police interrupt the match. Pia meets with a cop she thinks is clean, so she can give him the camera. And meanwhile, Cam and Mark wait for sunrise in a park. Mark tells Cam to go home to Thailand, but Cam still has one last family member to find. So, later that day, Cam interrupts Rose's press conference with his elephant to accuse her of murder, and he starts beating up her guards. Vincent tries to grab Korn and points a gun at Cam, but then Mark shows up and shoots him. Cam follows Korn to a room full of guards, and Rose is also there, to bask in the glory of her new, bejeweled elephant skeleton. That's what's left of Poryai. Cam goes completely out of it, which is kind of a problem since the guards are attacking him, but then one of them stabs Cam, and that snaps him into the second stage of grief. Anger. Turns out Cam was holding back this whole time, at least based on all of the bone-snapping noises we hear as more and more guards show up to get permanently crippled. Some of them have knives and cleavers, but goddamn, that doesn't help them a bit. Cam then goes straight up to Rose, and hey, Nathan Jones is back. This time, Cam focuses on smashing Jones' head, and it seems to be working. Then, Rose starts assisting with a whip. And to make matters worse, three more hulking wrestlers show up. You really have to admire Rose's investment strategy here. But then Jones throws Cam into the elephant skeleton, and that inspires Cam to tie two bones to his arms. That gives him the force he needs to deal some real damage to the wrestlers, and one by one, he takes them down. And then the bones break, and he uses the sharp edges to start cutting tendons to take the wrestlers out for good. Now, Rose's whip just isn't good enough against Cam without someone to guard her, and so Rose retreats to the rooftop. She tries to escape on a helicopter using an emergency hook, but Cam knees her off and smashes them both into the elephant skeleton. And as Mark gives a melodramatic speech, Cam and Korn reunite, and the credits roll. The style. This segment will be about capoeira. It's an interesting style with an interesting story. Plus, I've already covered Muay Thai. Besides that, I don't think there's ever been a movie with a capoeirista lead. The style is just too damn exhausting to fill a feature-length film. So, way back in the day, the Portuguese controlled the colony of Brazil and a portion of southern Africa, which they called Angola. Like any colonial power of its day, Portugal captured and bought African slaves and brought them to America to work on the plantations. Brazil imported more slaves than any other American nation. 2 in 5 slaves taken from Africa ended up in a Brazilian port. Brazil was also the last Western nation to abolish slavery in 1888. That's 23 years after the American Civil War, and 57 years after Brazil became the last nation to ban the Atlantic slave trade. So, in summation, Brazil has a lot of citizens with African and mixed African ancestors. Capoeira was invented by Afro-Brazilian slaves. Now, obviously, they weren't writing much down at the time, and even if they were, they wouldn't have written about their illegal combat training, so the style's specific origins are lost to history. But here's what we figure happened. Angolan slaves, dreaming of their freedom, wanted to be ready for the day that their escape or the slave revolt began. But if you practice your punches and kicks, the man with the whip is not gonna like that. So what do? Simple. You disguise one kind of physical activity as another. Capoeira is not only a fighting style, it's also a dance routine. And this routine just so happened to be dangerous if you got too close to the dancer. As a result, capoeira is a very rhythmic style, and practitioners put a lot of effort into spins and flips, and other moves meant to disguise the kicks and punches. Now, the original capoeiristas who used the style for combat would drop the extra spins and dance moves when they were fighting. The dancing might make you unpredictable, but it also wears you out fast, no matter how in shape you are. This combat variation mostly grew out of the Quilombo villages, settlements of escaped slaves who no longer had to keep up the pretense. After slavery in Brazil ended, there were a lot of people who knew capoeira and no longer had a job, either because the Quilombos disbanded since they didn't have to hide slaves anymore, or because the plantation owners hired European immigrants to replace the black slaves. It's not that the Europeans worked for less now that the Afro-Brazilians could earn a wage, it was just straight up racism. So the former slaves would use their fighting skills to commit crimes. And in 1890, the government banned capoeira. However, over time, the new economy stabilized, and capoeiristas would perform their art less to assault people and more to show off for tourists. In the 1930s, a couple of capoeiristas from Salvador started teaching this style as a formal martial art. By 1940, using capoeira was legal again. Modern capoeira is either a dance, a martial art, or both. It depends on how the practitioner wants to use it. Two capoeiristas in a ring could kick each other's asses, or they could turn the combat into a dance, showing off their impressive moves to a beat and never touching each other. It's a very interesting style, and we have every reason to believe that it helped influence modern breakdancing. Thanks for joining me again for today's film review, and I hope I'll see you next time as I begin the first post-game DLC and review a Western wuxia movie starring Kurt Russell as the funny foreign sidekick.